This is ABTV, Animal Bites Television. For animal lovers, by animal lovers.
My name is Brian Barczyk. I'm no zoologist, just a guy with a passion for animals. And that passion often brings up questions, and I'm in search of answers. And this week's question is how to understand reptile genetics. You're watching Snake Bites. Reptile genetics can sometimes be a little confusing, so today I'm going to try to simplify them. In all honesty, the reptile hobby sometimes uses the definitions of some of the genetics a little bit unusual, not like a normal geneticist would. But to make things simple, I'm going to use the exact terms that the reptile hobby used. But let's start by looking at some definitions of some terms you're going to hear in today's show.
A phenotype is a composite of an organism's observable characteristic or traits, such as its morphology, development, biochemical, or physiological properties.
So a phenotype is basically a paint job, or the way the snake looks.
An allele is an alternative form of a gene, one member of a pair, that is located on a specific location on a specific chromosome.
So the allele is that thing on a chromosome that holds the code for color and pattern mutations.
A gene is a molecular unit of heredity of a living organism. Genes hold the information to build and maintain an organism's cell and pass on genetic traits to offspring.
So now that we've got that out of the way, I want to talk about the five most common genetic variables that we see in the reptile world. That would be recessive, codominant, dominant, allelic, and polygenic. But let's go ahead and start with recessives. Something like this albino ball python. This happens to be a recessive mutation, which basically just means that it inherits the genes from both sets of parents. It's what we call homozygous.
Having a pair of identical alleles at the corresponding chromosomal loci, which result in a particular phenotype.
So to explain the simple Mendelian genetics behind a recessive mutation, if you were to take a homozygous animal, like an albino, and breed it to a normal snake, just like a wild-type ball python, all the babies are going to hatch out normal or wild-type looking, but what we call heterozygous, or carrying the trait for albinism.
Heterozygous is a condition in a cell or an organism having dissimilar alleles that code for the same gene or trait.
Now that we have the heterozygous or gene-carrying babies that appear normal, if we were to breed two heterozygous animals together, on average, one in four babies would come out the recessive or albino animal. But if you were to take the recessive albino or that homozygous albino and breed it to the heterozygous, on average, 50% of the babies would come out albino and 50% would be heterozygous. Now, lastly, if you're gonna take an albino to an albino, all of the babies would come out homozygous or albino. Now you can take it one step further and start combining different recessive mutations, things like this albino clown, and it gets a little bit more complicated, things like 1 in 16 odds. Now, I don't want to confuse you guys because I'm trying to simplify genetics, so let's go ahead and leave that for another show and move on to codominance. In the case of codominance, let's take a look at something as simple as a pastel ball python. It was really one of the first codominant mutations to ever come into the country from Africa. Kevin McCurley over at NERD was the one to prove it out. And they're cute little monkeys for sure, but when you take a codominant animal and breed it to a normal wild type animal, on average, 50% of the babies come out codominant right off the rip, so there's no heterozygous whatsoever. But what's interesting about them is if you breed two pastels together, oh, stop it, you little monkey, you get what is called a super pastel. Again, on average, one in four, much like the recessive mutations, it's the same average as one in four on average will come out super. And as you can see, the super pastel is just a more exaggerated version of the pastel. I have no idea what this guy's problem is, but some mutations in codominant do even more extreme stuff. Let's go ahead and take a look at this before I get lit up. Now, fireball pythons are another codominant mutation that actually cropped up over in Africa, but Eric Davies over in Europe was the first one to actually prove them out to be codominant. So when you breed two fires together, you get a pretty extreme version, which would be the black-eyed leucistic ball pythons. Now, Mike Wilbanks from Constrictors Unlimited worked with Eric bringing a bunch of animals in and really founded the first black-eyed leucistics in the country. which are really cool animals. But there's another extreme version, the completely opposite direction, with cinnamon pastels. Let's go take a look. Back in the late 90s, Greg Graziani produced the very first cinnamon pastels, and that's what he termed them. Over the last decade or so, the pastel has fallen off, and it's now just being called a cinnamon or a cinny. But it's a codominant mutation, which means that when you breed it to a normal, again, about half the babies are gonna come out cinny. Now, it's just kind of a darker animal that has some kind of interesting side patterns, but again, when you breed two cinnies together, you're gonna get, on average, 1 in 4 babies are gonna be a super version. But it's not like the pastel where you get a little bit of an exaggerated version of it. You get a solid black animal. It's kind of a dark brown, really, but nevertheless, it's still a gorgeous, gorgeous snake. Now, believe it or not, in the very early days, some people called these 8-ball ball pythons. Now they're just called super cinnies. Now, what's interesting about codominant mutations is once you get a super form like this super cinny, if you breed this to a normal ball python, every single baby is gonna be cinnamon, which is pretty cool. Moving on to the next genetic variant would be the dominant one. Now these guys work a lot like the codominant mutation. The only difference is there's no super form. A pinstripe ball python would be the perfect example of a dominant mutation, which again basically means if you bred a pinstripe to a normal or wild type animal, you're gonna get on average about 50% pinstripes. But then if you breed a pinstripe to pinstripe, you're not gonna get a super form at all, which is a little bit of a bummer because when I first produced the pinstripe ball pythons, I was really looking forward to a super pinstripe, not only from a color and pattern standpoint, just imagining how beautiful that could be, but also for the fact that if you have a super, then everything you breed it to, you're gonna produce pinstripes. Spider ball pythons are another example of that. But now I do wanna say, when you breed pin to pin or spider to spider, you do get an increased amount of pinstripes or spiders, the same as you would if you bred them together if they were codominant. So on average, you're gonna get 3 out of 4 pinstripes or spiders instead of 2 out of 4. But unfortunately, that last animal is on average gonna be a normal ball python. All right, guys, I'm gonna just throw a monkey wrench in the whole thing and talk to you about allelic traits. They're kind of crazy, but I'm gonna do my best to simplify it. Basically, an allelic trait is when two different mutations that occur on the same loci will produce a similar mutation. And I'm gonna go ahead and give you an example right now of that. A specter ball python is a codominant mutation, which again means that if you breed it to a normal, half the babies are gonna come out specter, right? Now, if you breed two specters together, just like any other codominant mutation, 1 in 4 on average is going to come out a super, which is called a super specter. That looks just like this, right? Now, this is where things get a little bit crazy. Let's go look at a yellow-bellied ball python, and I'm going to tell you what happens. So the yellow belly mutation is another codominant mutation that's been around quite a while, and it was really a surprising animal way back in the day because it produced something that was pretty amazing. When you breed two yellow bellies together, you get a white snake or an ivory ball python. Now this was basically the first real white snake that was produced in captivity in the ball python world. And believe it or not, way back in the day, these guys were selling for like $100,000. Now you can pick up an ivory for $500-$600. So it's pretty cool. It's a great, beautiful snake at an extremely affordable price. And again, typical codominant mutation, 50% on average babies come out, breed them together, 1 in 4 on average come out a white one. Now this is what the allelic part gets really crazy right now, guys. Again, we showed you the specter before, just like this. So we have a specter that produces super specter when bred together, and a yellow belly that when bred together produces an ivory. But when you breed a specter to a yellow belly, you get a kind of big surprise. And a mirror down at yellow belly ball pythons is the one that produced the very first super striped ball python. That's right, you breed these two together and you come out with these beauties right here. Now that's pretty amazing. But allelic traits aren't exclusive to yellow bellies and specters. There's one other mutation I gotta show you because it's super cool. Now the special ball python is much like the specter or yellow belly. It's a codominant mutation. So when you breed two special ball pythons that were proved out by Tom Baker in California, you'll get what they call a super special, which is again a kind of white snake that looks a little bit patterned. It's kind of cool. But when you breed these to a normal, 100% of the babies will come out special, just like any other codominants. I think you guys are starting to get the idea, right? And of course, this is where it gets a little bit more confusing. When you take a Mojave, which is again is a codominant mutation that when bred together, one in four on average produces another white snake, but looks very different than the super special. It's called a super Mojave. Again, pretty simple stuff, little feisty bugger, right? But what's interesting is when you take the special and the Mojave together, you get something completely different than a white snake. You get what's called a crystal ball python. And again, Tom Baker was the first one to achieve this goal many years ago, and I absolutely love crystal ball pythons. They're just really cool. But this all sounds kind of interesting because you're saying, hey, you know what? If I was to take, let's say, a pastel ball python, which is codominant, and breed it to a spider, which is dominant, which again acts kind of like a codominant, you would get something that was called a bumblebee ball python. So why does the super stripe or a crystal sound any different than that? It's like, all right, well, I got a bumblebee. Well, the difference is if you breed a bumblebee ball python, which is a double codominant, you're gonna get on average out of four babies, a bumblebee, a spider, a pastel, and a normal. Well, when you get into the allelic traits and you get something like a crystal ball python, you will never be able to produce a crystal ball python from breeding it to a normal. So when you breed a crystal ball python to a normal, all the babies will be either special or they'll be Mojave. There'll be no normals and there'll be no crystals. And that's because they're an allelic trait and not a double codominant. But so that's a little bit confusing, but I hope you can wrap your brain around it again. Again, what is happening is that the Mojave and the special or the yellow belly inspector are sharing a protein on an allele, but they're not separate from one another. So it's pretty cool. They make some really cool animals. In leopard geckos, there's a tremendous amount of polygenic traits, which basically just means selectively line breeding animals. Let's take, for instance, this hypo leopard gecko that is basically lacking almost all of the black pigment. This is basically the results of many generations of selectively breeding animals that have a low amount of black pigment. Each generation, you would target the least amount of black animals, raise them up, and breed them together. In every generation, you're gonna get less and less black pigment, eventually coming up with animals that have virtually no black pigment. Another great example of polygenic traits in leopard geckos would be the tangerine leopard gecko. Instead of breeding for a reduction of black pigment, you're breeding for the most orange animal as possible. And again, each generation, you're saving back the orangest animal, breeding it to another animal that is extremely orange, and each generation, you're gonna get more and more orange animals, sometimes resulting in incredible things. These are perfect examples of polygenic or line bred. But it's not exclusive to just leopard geckos. You see it in snakes too. Let me show you one project that I'm really digging. So you can basically use polygenics in almost any animal when you're breeding for a specific trait. It's basically just a line bred trait, right? So snow corns already have a little bit of pink and yellow in them. So we did several generations ago was starting to really target the most pink animals, thinking that we could really produce a beautiful pink animal. And this guy's a little feisty one. And believe it or not, you can actually even breed for temperament in some animals. We'll try to not breed that animal for temperament for sure. But this is the first results that we started to see from our coral snow project, which basically just is a higher amount of pink. And although it's a spectacular animal in its own right, we wanted to continue to take it as far as we possibly could to get the pinkest possible snow corns. And we're starting to get some animals that are pretty breathtaking. Take a look at this. This is probably four, maybe even five generations in now, but just look at that incredible pink color in a snow corn. Again, you can use polygenics in breeding for any specific trait. Sometimes the problem is with snakes is that it takes a while to raise them up. So a lot of times you'll see in lizards a lot more polygenics because it only takes a year to breed them, and you can start getting into the third, fourth, fifth generation in a relatively short period of time. Regardless, guys, I hope that this wrapped your head around snake and reptile genetics just a little bit. I know it's a little bit hard, but trust me, it's not as hard as you think it is. If you have any questions, go ahead and comment down below. I'll be happy to answer them. I hope you guys feel a little more confident in your ability to understand reptile genetics. For this week's Reptile Report, we'll be highlighting Field Herp Forum. Go ahead and check out the URL down below or click on the link in the description. So there it is. I hope you guys enjoyed the show and learned a little bit about reptile genetics. And as always, I'm tweeting and Facebooking my way through everything that happens here at BHB. So make sure to follow me over at SnakeBytesTV. Until next week, you've been watching Snake Bites.
Hi, I'm Peter Birch, an Aussie bloke who loves wildlife. My respect for nature started when I was a young boy in rural New South Wales. Since then, it's exploded into an obsession. New episodes only on Animal Bites TV.